Listening Library presents The Silver Blonde by Elizabeth Ross. Read for you by Lisa Flanagan. Note and filmography section read by the author. It's Only Shadows on the Wall. Sam Osteen, film editor. Prologue. Matinee. Step into a picture house on a sunny afternoon, and you can suspend time. Popcorn-scattered carpet under rows of tired velvet. The movie theater is the same the world over. Berlin or Los Angeles, it doesn't matter. Cigarette smoke unfurls into the projector light. The usherette leans against the wall and gazes up at the screen, a rerun of Casablanca. Ingrid Bergman is luminous. Bogart cuts a dash. This girl must have seen the movie a dozen times, but each time she's swept away. She slips into another life, shrugs off her own like an old coat. In Casablanca, Victor Laszlo wants Rick to join the fight, and Ilsa is torn between her two lovers. The nitrate print is gorgeous. The highlights sparkle. The dark tones are deep and rich. All the detail in the textures. Up on screen, the characters are evading Nazis, still trapped in Vichy-controlled Morocco. Outside the theater, people are dancing in the streets. May 8, 1945. Victory in Europe. The war is over. Chapter 1. Girl Friday. Clara raced upstairs as though pursued, taking the steps two at a time, grabbing the handrail without needing to look. One final leap to the landing. She could have been flying. The corridor was lined with cutting rooms on either side. She could hear the whir and babble of competing film soundtracks. Glorious. Like an orchestra tuning up. Her heart hammered in her throat as she reached Sam's door. Right before knocking, she caught herself. There's nothing more exquisite than wanting something when you're so close to getting it. The editor was not alone in his cutting room. The head of post-production, Mr. Thaler, and the screenwriter, Mr. Brackett, flanked him. Dialogue crackled from the speaker. Clara paused in the doorway, ready to back out. Sam turned.
Clara, come in. With you in a moment.
Clara perched on a stool by the film bench, folding her long limbs over one another. She heard Gil's teasing in her head. Tall and not worried about it. Clara pressed her lips together to keep from smiling. He had told her she was a shoo-in. He had told her she'd nothing to worry about. She straightened, rolled her shoulders back, head up. Confident, or feigning it at least. Had she made enough of an effort? She'd chosen her smartest skirt and decent shoes, the peach suede pumps. She should have worn lipstick, but makeup made her feel like a clown, and jewelry was discouraged. It could get caught on the film equipment. She'd read that in the post-production manual. The men parted slightly, and Clara peered past Sam's shoulder to the moviola, a metal contraption for viewing film footage, like an industrial sewing machine operated with a foot treadle. There was a close-up of Barbara Bannon frozen on the small screen. Glamorous Miss Bannon was the star of Letter from Argentin, famous for her side sweep of ash-blond hair and husky voice.
If I'm going to sell it, we need more pieces, some close-ups, said Sam. Her hands pushing him off, her feet scrambling. She reaches for the letter opener, that kind of thing. Right now, the struggle is too quick. We need to draw out the suspense.
Clara's ears pricked up. Nothing studio people said when it came to filmmaking was irrelevant to her. She hoarded information like this.
I hear she's difficult, said Thaler. Hates her co-star. Gives Howard a hard time, too. Changing lines. Storming off set.
Mr. Brackett smoothed his mustache.
She wants the widow character to be stronger, less of a limp noodle.
Impeccably dressed, he brushed a fleck off his dark navy suit.
I believe that is the expression she used.
Thaler shook his head.
She's playing a war widow, not a femme fatale. We're not making Gilda.
Clara had read about these rumors in Hedda Hopper's gossip column. Director Howard Hawks and leading lady Barbara Bannon reunite for Letter from Argentine, Bannon's first role since the death of her husband and co-star Gregory Quinn. Hawks is also producing the picture for Silver Pacific, with principal photography underway. Sources tell me that the production is off to a bumpy start, with thesps clashing on set. Rumor has it that Bannon's new co-star, erstwhile matinee idol Randall Ford, resents being cast as the villain in the suspense drama. The stakes are high all around. In this test of her star power, will audiences respond to Babe Bannon without her leading man and box office draw Gregory Quinn by her side?
Sam sighed. I'll talk to Howard about the inserts. The studio won't be happy. We're already behind.
Clara cleared her throat. Couldn't you use the stand-in? The men turned. Mr. Thaler blinked at her as if the furniture had started talking. A flush spread up her neck.
I mean for the close-ups of her hands and feet, she said.
This is Clara Berg from the Film Archive, said Sam apologetically, pushing up his shirt sleeves. I think I mentioned her.
Ah, Mr. Thaler barked. So she's the one.
He stood astride, feet planted, hands on his hips, like a sheriff in a western.
Sam tells me you applied for the apprentice editor position.
Clara stood up. This was her moment.
That's right.
She raised her chin and maintained eye contact even though her legs felt like jelly.
Quite the career move for a young lady. A union position with the promise of promotion.
His voice boomed unnecessarily. She was only a few feet from him.
That's the plan, sir, said Clara.
Her breath was shallow and her pulse ticked up.
Please say yes. Please say yes,
she silently implored.
And our boy's back from the war,
Thaler frowned. A pause of disapproval.
With families to support.
Thaler, it's 1946, said Mr. Brackett. War's been over for a year.
He winked at Clara. Mr. Thaler ignored him.
How old are you?
He asked. His eyes ran over her and she folded her arms, wishing she were wearing a cardigan over her thin blouse. Miss Simkin, the film librarian, had warned Clara about Thaler. He didn't promote women.
18. 19 in the fall, she added.
And once we've trained you up, who's to say you won't take off and get married? That's my concern.
A jungle cat began to pace inside Clara. She took a step toward him. In her pumps, they were the same height.
I'm not getting married anytime soon, Mr. Thaler, she said firmly. I'll be too busy working my tail off in the cutting room.
Mr. Brackett chuckled and slapped Mr. Thaler on the back.
Never heard of the modern woman?
He nodded toward Clara, and his oiled hair gleamed under the light.
We've got a Girl Friday on our hands.
She bit down on a smirk, grateful to the screenwriter for taking her side. She wondered if it was because she was friends with Gil. He and Brackett were partners, after all.
Clara is well-versed in post-production, said Sam, chiming in. She has a sharp eye and is quick to learn. Already helped us out on the bigger days when we were drowning in footage.
He nodded a smile, reassuring her.
She's very keen.
His eyes darted back to his boss and he pushed his glasses up, a nervous tick she'd noticed before.
Go on, Thaler. Give the gal a chance.
Roger Brackett was enjoying this. Mr. Thaler shrugged.
Well, Sam, he said reluctantly, if you're happy with it.
He relaxed his cowboy stance.
Okay, Miss Berg.
He smiled like the big bad wolf pretending to be Grandma.
We'll give you a shot.
Clara beamed.
I won't let you down.
She knew there would be no second chances.
Clara floated down.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.